aircraft carrier heads into the wind at 40 knots, the world's most powerful floating weapon. On her deck, a young pilot, Lieutenant Donald Watkins, prepares for the greatest challenge of his naval career. In a moment, he will be hurtled into the sky to face for the first time the dangers of a high-speed carrier landing. This is his story. Of the aircraft carrier, modern naval warfare was revolutionized, and a new breed of aviator was born, the carrier pilot. Today, his supersonic planes are capable of everything from a routine patrol to a devastating nuclear attack. But with all of this, the carrier pilot's problem remains the same. He is still a man who must leave a ship and fly out into the vastness of the ocean, fulfill a mission, then return to a pinpoint on his charts and land on a moving airfield. Lieutenant Donald Watkins, here relaxing at the Navy's traditional happy hour, has chosen to be such a man. With three other nuggets, new pilot just out of training, he has come to Miramar Naval Air Station near San Diego to join his first operational squadron, VF-96, the Fighting Falcons. Don must qualify in the Navy's hottest new all-weather fighter, the F-4H Phantom, a plane in which his squadron mates have set international speed and altitude records. With these men, Don will live, train, and fly.
Ever since I was a kid, I wanted to be a Navy flyer. I'm not exactly sure why. Lots of reasons, I guess. Maybe it was some old Randolph Scott movie with biplanes and Navy wings. Whatever it was, I know I'm right where I want to be.
For the first months at Miramar, to Don, the F-4H is a creature of textbooks and training devices. Before he can fly it, he must master every one of the aircraft's many functions. In an orientation trainer, he learns to keep cool in a hot situation, practicing techniques that might one day save not only his aircraft, but his life.
And have a fire, port engine, and I'm coming back out of afterburner, back to 90%. The fire warning light and starboard engine, I'm shut down the port engine, I'm maintaining my flying, not coming off.
All right, sir, you're not going to be able to restart your engines. Neither engine will restart at this time.
Eject.
Roger. Still at indication of fire. And carry out your procedure. Roger, very good. All right, sir.
I assume we just ejected here.
Yes, sir. And we just forgot one little old thing. When you ejected, you had a minus 20 feet altitude.
Oh, I've got 3,000 indicating
that. Negative,
there.
Minus 20.
Look.
Negative, yeah. Minus 20.
Oh. Okay, well, I'm the dead duck.
During his third week with the squadron, Don and another nugget pay a traditional call on their commanding officer. They are precisely on time, within seconds of the appointed hour. By custom, their call on Commander O'Rourke and his wife, Harriet, will last exactly 20 minutes. No more, no less.
How do you think you'll like flying the F-4A?
Oh, listen, it's a real dream come true. As a matter of fact, it's a real peculiar circumstance surrounding my introduction to the fact that I was going to fly F-4H. It's almost tragic, you might say. I received a phone call from what I thought was a prankster, saying it was from the assignments officer in Corpus Christi, and he said, "Don, would you like to come to my house tonight? You've been selected to fly F-4Hs." and I almost hung up the phone right there, thinking that he was just joking, and I asked, who was this? You know, who is this? And I'm going to hang up. But it all turned out that it was true, and I still can't believe it. I'm looking forward to my first hop.
May I get you some coffee?
I believe I would. I had a link trainer today, and I crashed it. So my first experience with the F4H cockpit here, and it was completely unsuccessful. So I believe I would like a cup of coffee.
After having spent my whole life going to school, I get impatient sometimes with the 5 months I've got to spend on the ground before I can fly this plane. But it's part of the job. I'm going to be handling a lot of potential destruction, and I can't afford to make any mistakes.
Carrier pilots train to fly into the near stratosphere. And the Navy takes pains to make sure they survive the experience. At a simulated altitude of 30,000 feet, a simple child's game teaches Don how lack of oxygen, hypoxia, can affect his thinking and coordination.
Now, try to speed it up a little bit. Come on, you can do better than that. A little faster. Now, hit your partner's hands twice. Okay, that's all. Hook up. Go ahead and hook up your oxygen. Get your mask back on. Get your mask back on.
One thing about San Diego, it comes pretty well equipped with the finer things in life. Girls. But I don't know about marriage. I can't see it. Not for now. Not with the kind of moving around I've got to do. Maybe I haven't found the right girl yet. I sure enjoy looking.
After months of training and study, Don finally gets his chance to fly the F4H.
Everybody says this will be a piece of cake. I hope they're right. I don't want to mess up. And I'm sure my radar observer in back feels the same way. You never know what you're going to get in a new airplane, but I think I can hack it. Anyway, they wouldn't trust me with millions of dollars worth of aircraft if I wasn't ready.
The Nugget's days are spent exploring a new world, feeling out the F4H, getting the touch, learning the plane's response to every demand. If there are apprehensions, doubts, this is the time for Don to work them out. The most vital part of Don's training is the daily bounce drill, simulating carrier landings using the meatball. The mirror landing system which guides carrier pilots safely to the deck. After 7 months of intensive training, Lieutenant Donald Watkins is now ready to qualify aboard an aircraft carrier. On the eve of departing Miramar, the Falcons engage in a traditional naval ceremony, the dining in. For Don and his squadron mates, it's a time of fellowship and farewell. As part of the evening's entertainment, the four Nuggets are called up to build a sentence word by word.
You fall in alphabetical order from the left, please.
That means you have to know how to spell.
This is a staggering problem, I reckon.
President, I'll start off with the first word by saying no.
Advice
will be considered.
Flying
this airplane called
the
F-4. H.
Venom.
Gentlemen, a toast. This is John F. Kennedy, the President of the United States.
Here.
Across the bay from San Francisco, Don boards the USS Ranger, the supercarrier from which he will fly.
It's incredible. It's the most unbelievable hunk of steel you've ever seen. And somehow just being here, knowing you're going to be a part of it, it gets to you.
Lieutenant Donald Watkins is no longer a novice. Now his abilities are about to be tested on the open sea. In the Revolutionary War, John Paul Jones fought from the 1st USS Ranger. Today, the 8th ship to bear her name is a $170 million powerhouse, her 4-acre flight deck over 1,000 feet long. As she puts to sea from San Francisco, she carries almost 4,000 officers and men, 92 attack aircraft, and Lieutenant Junior Grade, Donald Watkins.
The trouble with having to qualify is there's so much time to think about it. You know you're ready, but you keep asking yourself the same questions anyhow. It's not such a big deal. It's simple. Meatball, line up and airspeed. Then all you have to do is get your hook into that little wire. Everyone in the squadron had to qualify once. You wonder how they felt.
Busy deck comes alive with men and machines. Don's flight is not scheduled until tomorrow. Today, he can observe the feverish activity that goes into a launch.
Here's where it really gets tough. When someone misses the wires, you say to yourself, well, I'd have done this, or done that, or sucked off some power. But you don't really know. All you're sure of is your time is coming, and someone will be up here watching you.
That night, Don and Commander Dog Davison talk about the possible dangers of a weak launch off the steam catapult.
The likelihood of you getting a cold shot or a weak shot is highly remote. But you always want to be prepared for this eventuality. I mean, at least mentally. Be thinking about ditching. Somebody was just sitting around doing nothing someday. Just think, what would happen if at the end of this catch shot I went in the water? What are you going to do? Canopy jettison? Harness off? Guillotine out the top? You ought to run through that in your mind. You don't want to... Well, I mean, don't dwell on it, for crying out loud.
An aircraft carrier at sea never sleeps. long before daybreak, the pace of the ship's company quickens as the Ranger readies herself for the coming day. At 5 o'clock, Don awakens and begins his day. This morning, he will be called upon to qualify as a carrier pilot.
In your mind, you've already gone off the catapult about 1,000 times. You wonder what can go wrong. And then you think of all the things that it'll have to go right. Most of all, you keep coming back to the job, what it's all about, why you're here. Once I've actually qualified, I'll be a part of something pretty important. And there's a bit of pride about it. Because if anything ever happens, they'll be calling on me. And I know just how big a role that could be.
All right, gentlemen, you're going to be manning your airplanes in a few minutes. I just want to cover a couple of quick points, especially for you nuggets who are going out for the first time. The name of this game is carrier qualification. This is what the pattern looks like. Expect you to be on altitude when you come downwind and on speed when you hit the 180 here at 500 feet. Right on around, you'll be crossing the wake of the ship. It may seem a little bit unnatural to you at first, but this is where you have to go in order to be properly lined up with the angle. You should be able to pick up the meatball approximately this position. Start right on down the glide slope. Hold your speed steady. As soon as you hit the deck, come on with the power. Full cob. So that in case you miss a wire, you'll boulder and be off in good shape. Anybody have any questions?
Three levels above, the planes of VF-96 are prepared for the launch, spotted in takeoff sequence, well behind the catapults. Don is assigned to number 605. And his radar observer move across the deck to number 605. In less than 15 minutes, Don will be in the air.
I know other people will be looking at me. This is the carrier I'm going to deploy on. These are my friends. I'm going to be making my reputation. I pull a boner, everybody's going to know about it, and I'll have to live with it. I thought there was any slight possibility that I'd ever be involved in a bad accident or harmed in any way, I wouldn't be flying. I don't consider that possibility. I really don't. I don't figure that it's ever going to happen. I figure that I can always cope with the situation.
Plane director brings Don into final position on number 4 catapult. Within seconds, a steel bridle attaches him to the shuttle of the catapult, the giant steam slingshot which will hurl him off the carrier at 170 knots. As the deck crew scurries out of the way, Don will have a final chance to go over his checklist. Everything has to be right. Once he salutes, he's on his way. minutes later, Don and the other Nuggets rendezvous with their division leader. Already, they are over 60 miles from the carrier. Now the flight turns back. The Ranger heads into the wind. All stations are ready. Primary flight. Landing signal officer. The bridge. The meatball. Final 90-degree turn. Don sets his critical altitude and airspeed for the approach, crossing the Ranger's wake and moving down the glide slope. Don faces many more tests before he is a fully qualified carrier pilot. But the first time is always the hardest. And this morning, Lieutenant Donald Watkins has just passed his first and biggest hurdle. In the next 10 days, as the USS Ranger maneuvers off the West Coast, Lieutenant Donald Watkins will complete all the many tests needed to qualify him as a carrier pilot, landing his plane under battle conditions, night or day, in any weather. Then Don will join the Ranger for his first cruise as the giant carrier patrols the waters of the Western Pacific with the 7th Fleet. Along with the other more experienced members of Squadron PF-96, Don will spend 9 months on 24-hour call, poised on the outermost fringe of the nation's defense line. For Don, this 1,046-foot strip of steel, floating in the middle of the ocean, will be both a haven and a home.